out walking after midnight.
I'm Ann Cohn, and I'm the new managing director at Bristol Riverside Theatre. I'm thrilled to be joining BRT and to welcome you to the first production of our 30th anniversary season, A Closer Walk with Patsy Cline. I've only been at Bristol Riverside Theatre for a few weeks, and already I feel right at home. I can't think of a more exciting time to join the staff than during this landmark season. Susan and Keith have curated a wonderful selection of musicals and plays that represent Bristol Riverside Theatre's heritage and its future. Thank you for being a part of this journey. This is our third visit with this country music legend. Some of you may remember the summer production of Always Patsy Cline several years ago. Still more of you will recall our 2015 production of that musical, starring Joe Twiss and Jessica Wagner. Well, Jessica is back, and this is a fresh look at the talented woman who gave the world seminal country western recordings like Crazy and Walkin' After Midnight. Patsy was, in many ways, the first of the crossover artists, winning over traditional country western music fans and pop music audiences alike. But beyond that, Patsy, or the Cline, as she referred to herself, was a woman who endured both joy and hardship in her life. Between 1953 and her tragic death in 1963, Patsy was married, divorced, remarried, gave birth to two children, and survived a near-fatal car crash, all while winning acclaim for recording and performing songs in her own unique style. A Closer Walk with Patsy Cline tells the story of this musical icon's life using the songs that made her famous. Patsy will also be joined this time by the Jordanaires. So now, please join me as we take a closer look at A Closer Walk and see what it takes to bring Patsy to the stage.
Nashville was the domain of the male. Female singers were seldom seen and usually forgotten. Yet in a mere five-year career, Patsy would carry country music all the way to the top of the American pop music charts. Born Virginia Hensley on September 8, 1932, Patsy grew up living, eating, and breathing country music in the sleepy, laid-back town of Winchester, Virginia. Clearly, Patsy possessed a natural raw talent. In her heart, she knew she would make it to the top. It was simply a question of getting there. It was the era when radio was king. That's where the dream would begin. Patsy never missed an opportunity to get up on stage and feel the magic of an audience. But things were never too easy. Patsy's father had walked out, and at 15 she left school to help support her family. But she continued to develop her style by performing often 7 nights a week with a variety of local bands. By late 1953, Patsy had put together a demo tape, and in 1954, she was offered a recording deal by the independent label, Four Star Records. The terms were not particularly favorable for Patsy. She could only record songs written by four-star writers, but Patsy had next to no choice. She was in no position to call the shots, not yet. Then came television.
It's town and country time.
Patsy quickly became one of the regular performers on the Jimmy Dean program. Show regular Dale Turner recalls Patsy's debut performance.
There was a stir one evening, and this girl came in a red and white cowgirl suit with a big white hat, and everybody began whispering and everything, and Patsy Cline, you know, and they called her up to sing, and she blew the place away.
Pressures of performing during the week, plus weekends on the Jimmy Dean show, soon resulted in Patsy's divorce from her first husband, Gerald Cline. Patsy soon would dance and romance with Charlie Dick, and he accompanied her to Nashville for the sessions that produced Walkin' After Midnight.
I go out walking after midnight, out in the moonlight, just like we used to do. I'm always walking after midnight.
Patsy would soon find national television exposure on Arthur Godfrey's Talent Scout Show. Walkin' After Midnight became an instant country hit. But more importantly, it jumped onto the pop charts. Patsy Cline had arrived.
I stopped to see a weeping willow crying on his pillow. Maybe he's crying for me. And I
was a dream come true when in February 1957, Patsy was a special guest star on the showcase of country music, the Grand Ole Opry. Patsy received a thunderous ovation before she even sang a word. But it would take four more years before Patsy could consolidate her newfound popularity. At long last, Patsy was free to record any song she wanted when the four-star deal expired in 1960. Her path soon crossed with Nashville songwriter Harlan Howard.
I fall to pieces each time I see you again. But I mean, that was about it. And I said, I like that.
It's a great song. I said, well, yeah, it is a great song. I said, but I really think it's a girl song, Owen. I just don't think it's a boy's song. He said, that's all right. I said, you just don't record it. I said, I'm going to record it with somebody, and it's the number one record.
But I felt it was a good song, and I asked Patsy to do it.
This is my second record hit now, and I never thought I'd be able to get the first one, let alone the second one. Thanks to all you nice folks, you've made my I Fall to Pieces number one.
A record came on a jukebox, and I know we looked at one another, and you could see we both thought it was a good record, but we had no idea who it was. And so we asked Tootsie, and she said it was Hugh Nelson, and well, we didn't know who Hugh Nelson was.
And I'm crazy for thinking that my love could hold you. I'm crazy for trying, and I'm crazy for trying. And I'm crazy for loving you.
Patsy did record Crazy, and it turned out to be one of her biggest hits. It also was the record that gave Willie his first big composing break in Nashville.
Crazy, I'm crazy for feeling so lonely.
When she recorded Crazy, I was there when she insisted on re-singing it time after time, like a whole afternoon.
From the down-home studios of Nashville to the skyscrapers of Manhattan, and onto the world-famous stage of Carnegie Hall, the Grand Ole Opry brought classic country music to the Big Apple. Among the stars that historic night were Jim Reeves, Grandpa Jones, Minnie Pearl, Farron Young, Bill Monroe, and Patsy Cline.
Let's make her welcome here tonight, our favorite, Miss Patsy Cline.
This year, being our 30th season, Keith and I wanted to plan something that had in it an element for us, an element for the audience, and an element for the area. And so we felt that after having listened to our subscribers and hearing what they had to say, that they found the previous production we did of Patsy Cline extremely entertaining and that they really enjoyed it. So Patsy Cline is our bow to our audience and what they've told us they like. The previous production of Patsy Cline focused on a few intimate details of Patsy's life, with, of course, her wonderful music. This production is very much more of a biographical stance. You see her go from a young kid who walks into a radio station and demands an opportunity to sing to her Carnegie Hall presentation. You see her gain backup singers. You see her gain her own band. So it has a sense of progression to it that is different than the previous production. The challenges were not in casting Patsy Cline, because I and our entire audience fell in love with Jessica Wagner when she did the first production. She's been in two productions since and has been met with great acceptance. So that was an easy decision. The radio announcer is the character through whose eyes we see the life of Patsy Cline. And there was an actor who did the part of Mitch, the young man in Tuesdays with Maury, who then went on to do the dentist in Little Shop of Horrors, and then went on to play a lawyer in Rumors, and then just this last spring played the sadistic muleteer in Man of La Mancha. And I thought, who is more of a chameleon than Danny Vaccaro? So Danny Vaccaro will be playing Little Big Man, which is the name of the radio announcer, and a couple other characters for such an amazing chameleon. Then we have the backup singers, four boys who work in the studio and become her backup singers. Now, we sort of fooled around with the history of this because, in essence, they weren't four boys that were in the studio. But we thought, what a fun idea if they developed with her that way, since we aren't given any context for her backup singers within the piece. So that's just a little fun addition we put in there. I think in this production, it's fun to watch Patsy mature, to go from a kid to an accomplished performer to a star. And I think that in the previous production, you didn't really have the opportunity to see that progression. And Jessica is doing an absolutely amazing job with that. It's really difficult to say what my favorite song is because so many of them are so, so good. I think that it's easy to say Crazy, or it's easy to say A Closer Walk, or it's easier to say Walking After Midnight, or Bill Bailey, which was a fabulous song she did. I would be very hard put to say what song is my favorite. I think Patsy Cline's popularity that has lasted throughout heaven knows how many years rests on the fact that she sang songs that are about real emotions, real feelings that everybody's had and everybody has experienced, besides the fact she had one of the most penetrating voices. And by penetrating, I don't mean by sound. I mean the warmth in her voice made you feel like she was singing just to you, not to everybody in the world, but to you as an individual, singing to your situation. And I think that's why she maintains the popularity that she still has today.
My approach to this role was with a lot of research. I, of course, listened to whatever recordings I could of Patsy. I watched any sort of YouTube video or any scrap of video recording I could find of her. And there are a few different biographies and things out there of her life, so I read all of those. But mostly it was a lot of listening and trying to watch her. What's interesting about her is there's not a lot of video recording of her actually speaking. It's mostly her singing, which is very different from today because we have so many talk shows and things like that where people are interviewed all the time. And it wasn't quite like that with her. So there's a great recording that, not recently, but came out posthumously of her at a place called Cimarron Ballroom. And that's kind of the only recording that I have of her speaking. So that's kind of how I approached her speaking voice. And then, of course, her singing voice is listening to all of her amazing, amazing recordings. Before I did Always Patsy Cline, I grew up in Texas. I grew up on Patsy Cline. I remember taking road trips with my family in the car, and my mom always had, well, in those days, a cassette of her greatest hits. And I remember singing along to Walking After Midnight when I was basically in diapers, so I knew a lot of her music. I didn't know a lot about her actual life and how she lived and things like that. So that's what I got to find out before Always Patsy Cline, and now I just get to delve deeper, which is great. This show differs mainly for me because we actually get to see Patsy from a young age. So when she first sings on the radio in Winchester, Virginia, where she comes from, which actually happened in real life, up into basically her death, which is great because you get to see how she matures as a performer, different material, and it's a lot of fun for me to delve into the different parts of Patsy's life. Some of the challenges for this production, finding exactly where Patsy is in her life, because it doesn't necessarily say the year or the date in the script or what she's going through, so we kind of have to take context clues and decide where to put those, and then also just basically how to negotiate Danny's character. Danny Vaccaro plays a DJ in Winchester, Virginia, who kind of acts as our MC, and then a few different fun characters that you'll get to see. Just seeing how that kind of works with Patsy and her concerts and things like that, because in this one it's mainly just me performing as Patsy, which is really exciting. But negotiating how to make a story out of those two things. Susan and I have really worked on, again, the journey of Patsy from basically a young girl into an adult woman. She didn't, unfortunately, live very long on this earth, but she did a lot, and she accomplished a lot, and she really lived a full life. So there's a huge journey that Susan has helped me shape from when she was a teenager up into her late 20s, you know, when she turned 30. So in this show, I get to wear 11 costumes designed by Linda B. Stockton, our amazing costume designer here. And you'll have to watch out for how quickly I get to change from one costume to another sometimes. Patsy Cline remains popular today, I think, because of her music. I mean, her voice just catches you. Whenever you hear it in the background or on the radio, automatically it's so unique and so full of life and soul that it's really universal and timeless. My favorite part of the show right now is probably all the up-tempo numbers. There are a few different songs I get to sing in this one, which is exciting, like Stop, Look, and Listen, and I Don't Wanna. So right now I'm having a lot of fun with the up-tempo numbers, which is interesting because Patsy always loved doing her up-tempo numbers the best as well. So I find that funny. But I don't know. It always changes with these kinds of shows because it's so reliant on the audience and you all coming in and reacting and having fun, and we get to have fun together. So. My favorite Patsy Cline song has to be Crazy. It's just a great song. It's a great song.
I drew a lot of inspiration from the real places that Patsy would have been performing at, even though some of them are kind of an amalgamation of different places. Like the Lone Star bar that she plays in is kind of a combination of my experiences in a lot of, I guess what you could call honky-tonks and dive bars through the Midwest and the South. Places like Grand Ole Opry, I did some research into what the background, the scenery would have looked like in the 50s and 60s, and abstracted that into the lighting. Carnegie Hall, the script calls for a very elegant setting. So I tried to emphasize what Rob, the set designer, had given us by emphasizing some of the columns. So a lot of the places that we see, like Grand Ole Opry and Carnegie Hall, are really based on what the real places would have been like. And then that couples with the tone of the song, but also what's going on in Patsy's life at the same time. So there's a combination of a realistic setting along with things that are more esoteric and emotional. I think there are about 5 to 7 different locations. Then there are one or two that are a little bit more on the vague side. They're not specific locations. They just talk about Patsy being at a different performance. So it isn't like we made anything up, but we tried to create something that was in between, so that the audience has a variety of things to look at. So we had the very. A light cue is a different look. Like for one of the concerts, when she starts the song, there might be a light cue which is very big and bright and open, really highlights all the performers. And then at the end, there might be something that reshapes the space, reshapes how the audience sees the stage, that some of the lights might dim, some of the lights might brighten up. The spotlights on her might zoom in a little bit so it's more accentuating her face. And that would be a light cue or 2 or 3 light cues to achieve that. Overall, we've got about 200 right now, which is about average for a musical like this that's around. One of the downsides of being a lighting designer is that there's a lot of drafting and a lot of keeping track of hundreds and thousands of different numbers. Each light has 5 to 10 different numbers associated with it. Keeping control of all that is one of the things a lighting designer does, but one of the programs that is used fairly commonly also allows us, with a little bit of extra work, to take a look at what some of these lighting cues will look like beforehand. One of the things I was able to do was to do what's called storyboarding, actually do renderings of what a 3D virtual version of the set looks like with approximations of what the lighting cues will look like. One of the big frustrations of being a lighting designer is that there's this big crazy rush, and then everybody sits down in the theater for the first technical rehearsal, and oftentimes that's the first moment that the director sees what the lighting designer's intentions are. I hate that moment because if you're not on the same page, it makes for a very long evening. But fortunately, what I was able to do was to show Susan, the director, what a lot of these images, what these cues would look like beforehand. That's relatively new to this business, but what it means is that once we start the technical process, we're on much better footing. And we can take the show from what is a very basic point and very quickly progress it into an even better show because we've gone through that initial language beforehand. So it's just the use of not necessarily common technology, but technology that's inherent to the process already, a slight twist to it, and a little bit more work on the front end for me, puts the production on a much better footing by the time we get in the theater. What the audience should be looking for in terms of lighting is the suggestion of the different locations, Carnegie Hall, the Grand Ole Opry, not only in terms of echoing the real physical space, but also how Patsy's life is shaping up at the time. For example, when we first go to the Grand Ole Opry, she's tentative. She's much younger in her career, so the feel of it is a little bit more constrained. And then by the time we get to the third number, she is Patsy Cline, not just the celebrity, but someone who is a very full performer and much more confident. So hopefully the lighting won't be too obvious to suggest that, but the space and the set should feel more open and more dynamic. And with each of the locations, there is a little bit of a change of shape, sort of an arc to how it progresses that hopefully mirrors what's going on in Patsy's life at the same time. I think Patsy Cline is still popular today the same way that Shakespeare is still popular and relevant. In terms of her being a storyteller, she found a very unique way in to expressing what was going on in her life that I think then resonated with so many other people. It wasn't about these grand epic things. It was about a real woman who was experiencing everything else that every one of us experiences in life, of lost loves and frustrations. And the way she sang was a very natural and honest way in. I think that, even 30 and 40 years later, she still resonates with people because of the passion in her voice, but also the story that she was telling, not just through the words of the song, but how she sang it and how she phrased it as a musician. My favorite Patsy Cline song would have to be Crazy. There are others that I've kind of come to realize that are great songs over the past year or so working with this show, but Crazy goes back to both my parents, they weren't necessarily crazy, but we're big Patsy Cline fans, and I grew up listening to all kinds of country music, folk music, thanks to them, but it was their interest in, and love of Patsy Cline that I remember Crazy being one of the first songs that I can remember from being a little kid.
Crazy for feeling so good.
On Ask the Pet Vet, sometimes pets who have diabetes can get better with proper diet and insulin.
Pancreas recovers and starts making insulin again, which means they won't need injection.
New episodes of Ask the Pet Vet every Sunday at couriertimes.com. Monday on Navigating Life, if you're a senior with health issues, things can easily get overwhelming.
We're going to take a look at some healthy habits you should strive for.
Check out a new episode of Navigating Life every Monday at couriertimes.com. Tuesday on Cook This, bring the taste of the boardwalk into your home with homemade funnel cake.
They're so fun and super nostalgic.
Check out a new episode of Cook This every Tuesday at couriertimes.com. Thursday on Eat This, lessons on eating a full English breakfast from author-musician Wesley Stace, also known as John Wesley Hart.
It would help if you could hold your fork properly.
Check out a new episode of Eat This every Thursday at couriertimes.com. Friday on Cheers to You, Adrian checks out the weekend festivities at Bucks County Brewery.
A normal Friday here is like Times Square on New Year's Eve.
New episodes of Cheers to You every Friday at couriertimes.com. Friday on Garden Minute, you need to get real creative with the plants you choose if your garden is in a shaded area.
Use colors like lime green and green and white foliage to help brighten up the area.
Check out a new episode of Garden Minute every Friday at couriertimes.com.